It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. It's been too hard living, but I'm afraid to die. 'Cause I don't know what's up there beyond the sky. It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome to the first 100 days, LGBTQ rights, racial equity, and reproductive justice. My name is Brad Sears. I'm the founding executive director at the Williams Institute, which is a research center on LGBT law and policy. We are so honored as part of our 20th anniversary series to bring you this afternoon, or this evening's program. We're so honored to bring you this program, and I'm so excited to have the panelists here, of course, Rashad, Alexis, thank you, Congressman Takano, and of course, my colleague, Jennifer Chacón, as well. I think this panel reflects our institute's commitment to not just doing work that's narrowly focused on sexual orientation and gender identity, but really we see our job as doing research on any issue that impacts LGBTQ people in our full diversity, including racial equity, reproductive justice, and immigration issues. As I said, this is part of our 20th anniversary series, and I'm excited that we're gonna have our national gala also remote, so you can join us on June 9th, and we're gonna announce two great partnerships with some of the folks here. On June 9th, we'll be announcing a new, kind of the first ever law teaching fellowship on race and sexuality, where we actually have two fellows joining us, a joint program between us and the critical race studies program. And I'm glad Alexis is here. We've been working a lot with Sue Dunlap and others at Planned Parenthood over the last few years to help build out a center at UCLA Law focused on sexual and reproductive health and justice. We'll be making a very exciting announcement about another law teaching fellowship as well on June 9th. So the event information is in the chat. Please come back and join us. And with that, we're gonna get on with this exciting program. I'm gonna announce our moderator tonight, or introduce our moderator tonight, Janine Jackson, who is the Program Director of Fairness and Accuracy in Reporting. She's also the host of a weekly show, a podcast, Counterspin, that airs on over 150 stations across the nation. So thank you, Janine.
Thank you so much, Brad, for that lovely introduction. And welcome again, everyone, to the first 100 days, LGBTQ rights, racial equity, and reproductive justice, brought to you by the African American Policy Forum, the Williams Institute, the Center for Intersectionality and Social Policy Studies, and the Critical Race Studies Program. I am Janine Jackson. I am a proud board member of the African American Policy Forum, as well as the program director at FAIR, the Media Watch Group. Tonight, I'm taking the reins temporarily from my dear friend, Kimberly Crenshaw, as host for this special edition of Under the Black Light. And I'm thrilled and honored to be here with this collection of panelists and with all of you. So we're marking President Biden's 100th day in office. And tonight we're gonna be discussing the returns, the early returns, if you will, of an administration put into place in the aftermath of an incredibly fraught election. Indeed, if you compare it to the last 100 days of the Trump administration, a time when the country came perilously close to implosion, it's probably understandable to congratulate the new administration for simply having returned us to safer harbors. But merely pulling back from the ledge, we know, is a minimalist measure for grading this administration. It's a bar that's just too low for our aspirations as a country. So throughout presidential history, this 100-day marker has had meaning as a harbinger for what was to come. Was it gonna be steadfast progress, reactionary movements, or a political stalemate? Franklin Roosevelt, who many people are now pitching as the president whose legacy Biden is taking up, stormed out of the gates of inauguration in the midst of the Great Depression and launched the New Deal in his first 100 days. Lyndon Johnson passed legislation that became the Civil Rights Act in his first 100 days. Now, of course, the tragic circumstances of Johnson's early days in the White House carry a unique weight, but he took the chaos of a deeply divided political era to drive through legislation that social justice advocates had been pushing for a long time. So this marker of 100 days, it's come to represent not just the ability of a new president to quickly make their mark, but it also acts as a kind of tone setter for the rest of the presidential term. On domestic issues, the Biden administration has surprised people who expected him to be kind of the centrist heir to a Clintonian third way politic. He surprised them with this momentous COVID stimulus bill. And that economic progressivism, as we could call it, that's been added to a willingness to acknowledge systemic racism in the United States and to implement race-conscious redistributive policies with sweeping legislation. Last night, he said white supremacy is terrorism, you know, along with saying, trans Americans, this president has your back. Those aren't things we're used to hearing, right? So our relief is completely understandable, but it doesn't mean we don't stay mindful of whether the Biden administration really achieves the decisive action that would actually address issues of police violence, of voting rights, of gender justice, and of immigration reform. And his administration has contradicted some of the initial posturing or what we initially understood, particularly on immigration, where we've seen deportations ramped up and children still at the border in ICE custody, and then an attempt to maintain Donald Trump's cap on refugee admission. So, you know, there are lots of things we need to keep in mind. And as highlighted in today's essay from Kimberly Crenshaw that's on AAPF.org, the Chauvin conviction and the killing of Micaiah Bryant were stark reminders of how our legal structures are often rooted in white supremacy. And so this shared history of genocide, of slavery, of apartheid, continues to stunt our ability to even imagine alternatives and to see our common humanity, which is really a prerequisite for imagining those alternatives. So for the Biden administration and for our society as a whole to confront the conditions that stand in our way, there have to be multiple reckonings with racial justice, with reproductive rights, with immigration reform, and with LGBTQ issues. So to help us do precisely that tonight, I'm honored to welcome our esteemed group of panelists to kind of diagnose, to take a look at this first 100 days. I will introduce them again. We're going to be speaking with Rashad Robinson, President of Color of Change, Alexis McGill Johnson, President and CEO of Planned Parenthood, Jennifer Chacón, Professor of Law at UCLA and author of Immigration Law and Social Justice, and with Congressmember Mark Takano, the US Representative for California's 41st Congressional District. Thank you all, our panelists. So throughout this Blacklight event, as regular return visitors will know, we always want to hear from you. So please share your thoughts in the Zoom chat room or tweet us at AA Policy Forum. You can expand the conversation across social media by following AAPF on Twitter and Facebook and using the hashtag under the Blacklight. And you can send us comments and questions through that Zoom platform, and we're going to be sharing them as many as we can get to throughout with our panelists throughout the event. We'll do our best to keep up with that feedback. So let's dive right in with Rashad Robinson. Rashad, I'm turning to you first as a longtime organizer, thinker, and policymaker. So last night we heard Joe Biden's remarks to a joint session of Congress. And let's reflect for a moment on how racial justice activism was a condition, really, of this presidency's possibility, right? You have said, we know what racial justice can do for an election, but the path forward now lies in deciding what an election can do for racial justice. So I wonder, how you're assessing now this relationship between the presidency and racial justice, given, you know, the centrality of the racial reckonings we've seen this summer, the pushes for justice we've seen over the past year, the moves that the administration, the Biden administration has made thus far, and then the president's comments last night. Where do you see us?
Yeah, well, first of all, thank you. It's, you know, an honor to be here with such incredible and important think tanks and institutions and research centers, as well as my fellow panelists. So, you know, this past summer, racial justice became a majoritarian issue. The upticks in voter registration, the what we saw in the polling, the fact that many of us thought that the best we could do in terms of activism was clap outside of our windows or uplift investigative journalism until racial justice brought people into the streets, motivated people to action, created a whole new context in terms of the engagement around so many important issues. And so because racial justice definitely ushered in this, you know, this moment that we're in, you know, I think it's important that we both recognize the context that we're actually in, all the dynamics of a United States Senate that is, you know, closely divided, all the ways of the structural barriers to actually achieving things. But we also keep very clear that we have to hold the line between real solutions and fake solutions, corporate enablism versus corporate you know, accountability, what's a good use of our time, which is what is not a good use of our time. And so I actually, knowing that President Biden ran as a restoration candidate, right? Very different than President Obama, who ran as a change candidate, and even Donald Trump, who ran as a change the rules candidate. The archetype of a restoration candidate kind of wants to sort of take us back to a good old days. There has been ways in which our collective movements have actually pushed in ways, have tilled the soil in ways, have helped to achieve things in ways that I actually didn't necessarily know would be on the agenda. And at the same time, I think we're constantly wrestling with these ideas of a limited idea of what's possible, right? And so, you know, I think that if I'm looking through the sort of lens of where we're at right now, I've got to say that I'm you know, I'm impressed about some things, and I think that there's more to go. And I feel like every time a journalist calls me about every single thing that the Biden administration does that's connected to racial justice, I keep saying it's a good step forward. It's a good first step. And, you know, that's better than not being able to say anything's a first step, right? If they had come out the box with a bipartisan police commission, you would have been hearing me say something very different. I would have been calling that as a fake solution. But they've worked things into budgets. They've actually sort of tried to use the levers of power. The cabinet officials have engaged us on a set of issues. And make no mistake, what we've won so far are not the sort of top priorities on my list, but they are steps in that direction. And part of the work forward is us being able to continue to push, press, and can change dynamics so that what we want to win is more and more possible.
Let me just follow up with one question about pushing forward, because when you describe Biden as a restoration candidate, you know, and going back to previous times, I know that many, not just Republicans, but many people I'd stop on the street would say, oh, no, he's extremely progressive. You know, he's pushing for incredible change, you know, and part of it is kind of the definitions that we're working with. So how do we kind of mm-hmm. define those terms, you know, or shape those terms in terms of our expectations, so that when people talk about, well, we're going back to the good old days, we're able to say, no, those aren't days we want to go back to. And in fact, that's not what seems like it's happening necessarily.
I mean, well, he ran as a restoration candidate. Like, I mean, whether or not he's governing as a restoration candidate, we can, you know, certainly have that conversation. But if you look at the set of actors that were on the stage along with him during the Democratic debate, he was certainly a restoration candidate, and a restoration candidate in a very different way. I mean, he didn't spend a lot of time even meeting with or engaging with grassroots organizations in both in the primary and the general election, right? He did run sort of a incumbent style campaign. And so there was a whole lot of questions about sort of what would be possible. And I do think that the context of what movements can build, the energy, the relationship to what is possible, both raising the floor on what's acceptable and pushing the ceiling up on what's possible, has created a whole sort of dynamic in which we're able to win more. We can move things further. We're also sort of coming out of the last 4 years of what we experienced. And so there's a lot of things that may just feel good in the first 100 days. And that's why I think it's really important that we hold complete judgment, right? And I've, as I've had conversations with the administration, I've constantly not talked about the first 100 days, but talked about 2022 and talked about the story that we're gonna need to tell out in the world about what change looks like. And so what we're gonna be coming up against, right, after this 100 days is actually some of the really important things. Will Biden actually engage and lean in around the filibuster? Because in 2022, I can't go to Black communities and say, hey, we couldn't pass this legislation because there's something called the filibuster. Now sit down and let me explain the filibuster. Oh, and don't worry, I need you to go back out and vote the same way you voted before, because I'm going to explain that, you know, all these things are on the line or all these things are achievable. So yes, I think like some of the things specifically around the putting real money in people's pockets, dealing with COVID, a whole set of things that we can absolutely celebrate while also recognizing that we actually haven't quite gotten to the deep structural stuff. The structural stuff that actually changes the rules long-term and can be a force multiplier for the type of long-term change, long-term power building, whether it's, you know, actually getting through police reform that's at scale and is and actually moves us forward, whether it's actually dealing with things like voting rights, which will determine whether or not we can actually express our will for a better future moving forward. That's sort of what we're engaging in. But for someone that ran as a restoration candidate, he is governing, I think, in many ways different than I think a lot of us imagine.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that. And I think we're all going to be wanting to engage just those questions of what's possible and symbol versus substance. Thank you very much, Rashad. Alexis, we're going to go to you now. Expanding on some of the things that Rashad has just said, particularly this distinction but on issues where there's majority support, and yet we have a governing minority, right? So we are not able to push through things that we know the US public overwhelmingly wants, right? Reproductive freedom is clearly another one of those issues that has had, has now, has long had popular support, but has been curtailed time and time again, meaningfully by powerful minority interests. So what were your hopes, I guess, for a democratically controlled reproductive freedom agenda at the beginning of this administration? And has that changed? What is your assessment at this point?
Well, first of all, thank you also for allowing me to join this conversation with some dear friends. I'd love to just pick up where Rashad left off in the conversation, because I think that is the dynamic. What is possible federally that we can achieve at the same time recognizing the fact that there is a vocal minority that is controlling so many of the levers of power in our states that is also addressing, you know, challenging some of the issues that we very much care about. When I listened to the speech last night, and I think about the kind of transition, that process that we've had as an organization, as a movement, vis-a-vis the Biden-Harris administration, I can honestly say this administration has made so much progress in the first 100 days on our issues, right? Undoing a lot of the damage that we've seen in the last 4 years. But I think we have to draw a distinction between what we heard last night, which was like this amazing, expansive, inclusive, New Deal-like programming, you know, that the Biden administration is advocating for, this notion that we can actually, you know, we need to restore and rebuild trust in government, stand with labor, champion the dignity of work and care, speaking plainly, you know, about race equity and white supremacy and privilege, and speaking directly to trans people, speaking directly to trans youth. And in all of that, I sat and I listened for all of my allies, all my friends who I sit and engage with at tables, you know, to fight back with. There was actually no mention of reproductive freedom. And I think about that in the last 100 days, because in the same 100 days, what we've seen is over 500 restrictions to, you know, abortion that have been introduced to the states that are going to disproportionately impact people of color, impact trans and non-binary folks and people with low incomes. And the same states where we have seen some of the most onerous voter suppression bills, we've also seen, you know, these active restrictions as well as legislation attacking trans youth. So it's happening in a sense, in a space where, like, there's literally no state in the union where banning abortion isn't popular, right? It is a majoritarian issue. It's a mainstream issue, in fact. Every state has a majority for support for sexual and reproductive health. So I think I come at it from the place of, if we have to be intentional about building policy around the canary in the coal mine, right? The most marginalized, the most harmed, so that we don't continue to replicate the existing structures and hierarchies. How do we think about the very intersectional manifestation in this administration? We've seen incredibly inclusive personnel decisions. We've seen these policies, these favorable policies like Title 10, the repeal of the global gag rule, the lifting of the bans on restrictions on REM so that we can serve patients through telemedicine with medication abortion. And at the same time, we also see the thing that we probably most fear in the reproductive rights movement, the notion that reproductive rights are going to be treated like a bargaining chip, because we're going to fall off the table immediately among negotiation. So we're fighting so hard against the antis and the folks that we know are sitting in Congress, but we also have to negotiate among our allies. And it's not just we have to fight for the right, you know, in Congress, we also have to fight in the courts, where there are 17 cases that are literally one step away from this newly remade Supreme Court that could overturn Roe. So, you know, I think about what it means kind of in the first 100 days where we have a pro-choice majority, you know, but we also have to find these like make me do it moments, right? We have a new deal, an opportunity to like respond to this crisis with, you know, this creation of opportunity, but we also still need to have some LBJ moments, right? To say like, this is what needs to happen so that we don't get traded away. And one of our strategies, I think, has been to think about how do we intersect with all of the various priorities of the Biden administration. We saw right after they were elected, the Biden-Harris administration put out their priorities. It was COVID-19, it was fighting systemic racism, the economy, and climate change, like incredibly ambitious. And I think that's what we saw starting to be laid out last night. But we also know that Planned Parenthood patients don't live single issue lives. We need to connect the dots between the notion that these fights put patients at the center, right? And put patients at Planned Parenthood at the center, and our work is to continue to connect the dots. So I think about COVID-19, I think about the executive orders that came out the box right in the beginning last year, March, April, where there were incredible onerous restrictions on abortion, saying that it wasn't time sensitive. Workers were being literally told that their bodies are essential and they need to show up, and yet their ability to make decisions about their bodies weren't. We saw racism, and I think we'd all agree, COVID has laid bare the fact that racism is a public health crisis. We know that the Biden administration has planned a lot around Black maternal health, very little around how we work to repeal Hyde. We've also seen the economy. We know that birth control and the ability to control your own body is responsible for, you know, our ability to increase our wages and make sure that we are able to live the lives that we imagine. And recently, there was just a great study on climate change that we've long understood is an issue that is impacting young people's decision to decide whether or not they will decide to have children or start their family. And yet it's also the toxins in the environment are plummeting, you know, sperm count because of climate change. So there are all these ways in which these intersections are there. And yet the inability to name it with the bully pulpit that the president has in his first 100 days, even though he is passing these executive orders, really does, I think, challenge our ability to organize strongly so that people understand and our allies understand that this is a central issue. It's a critical issue that will help us move an agenda forward.
Thank you. Thank you very much for connecting those dots and also for pointing out that although we're talking about the presidency and that is the focus, there our multiple arenas here. There are the courts, there are the state level, our fight is in all of these places, but there are things that we can ask of a new president in terms of exercising what influence they have in those arenas. So thank you very much for that, Alexis. Jennifer, we're going to go to you now. Part, of course, of talking about the first 100 days means understanding, as we all do, that Biden, where was he starting from, right? You know, he was starting from a base of just the rotting architecture of the Trump administration, particularly when we're talking about immigration. But then also, it's important to understand that problems didn't start with Trump. There was a regime that pre-existed Trump. In your area of scholarship on immigration, if we're kind of talking glass half full, glass half empty, well, you know, we have seen the rollback of some of the worst dimensions of Trump's attack on immigrants and on immigrants' rights. But please tell us about how we need to balance that, you know, with an understanding of other things that predated Trump and Biden's ability to unravel them. You know, how much do you see him carrying forward? How much do you see him limited in what he can do?
Thank you so much for that question. And I think when we think about how much work there is, we have to go not just back to the Trump administration, but way back and think about sort of the origins of our immigration law and our immigration history. So since I'm a professor, I will go way back and think about the way that anti-Black racism and slavery and the displacement of indigenous people were our foundational choices in the United States. And those choices are built into our immigration history. So we can think about the nation's first form of border enforcement as forcing and keeping indigenous people off their own land. And we can think about the way that our laws required the construction of racial categories so that people legally categorized as Black could be enslaved and denied legal personhood, and free Black people could be legally subjugated as needed to preserve that system of enslavement. And our immigration and citizenship laws and our immigration enforcement system were a really important tool in constructing and maintaining that racial order. That's why citizenship was limited to those designated as white in 1790. From that point forward, and even after the formal abolition of slavery, our immigration law has continued to reflect and reinforce ideas about who's racially fit to be a U.S. citizen. We had Chinese exclusion and laws that left people from Asia racially ineligible to naturalize until the mid-20th century. Even as European immigrants were starting to be integrated into whiteness, we saw the criminalization of Mexican immigrants crossing the border to work in the 1920s. And those same criminal laws continue to be used today in ways that criminalize migrants from Mexico, Central America, and the Caribbean, with everything from en masse border prosecutions to the Secure Communities program that was rolled out by President Obama and sustained by Trump that makes state and local law enforcement agents into frontline immigration officers, despite their lack of training and their frequent defaults to racial profiling. So immigration enforcement and the criminal legal system are working together in ways that they have always worked together, defining racial categories, reproducing racial hierarchies, constructing an exclusionary narrative of who can be a citizen. So the Biden administration doesn't just need to contend with the policies of the previous president, but with foundational choices that have always limited the promise of democracy and equality. But there is no doubt that the policies of the Trump administration have complicated the efforts to move immigration policy forward in a more promising direction. So we can think about the Trump administration. They made more than 1,000 changes to immigration law through regulation, policies, operating instructions, executive actions, and presidential proclamations. There's no way to even begin to reckon with this in the 3 minutes I have. But in addition to the widely known travel bans on entries from several predominantly Muslim countries, there were orders that substantially changed interior immigration enforcement policies. There were changes to asylum regulations resulting in what advocates labeled the death to asylum rule because of its significant adverse impact on asylum processing. There was the Remain in Mexico policy that required tens of thousands of asylum seekers to wait in Mexico, not their country, for the date of their asylum hearing, often in dangerous and even deadly conditions. There was deliberate and cruel official policies of family separation that garnered national headlines. And there was a change in the public charge rule that caused many non-citizens to avoid accessing earned and needed governmental benefits in the midst of a deadly pandemic. So the Biden administration had its work cut out for it. And it has made some inroads in dealing with these significant and devastating policies. But you can see how we begin from a baseline that isn't very good. We move through a period of devastation. And now we're working back to the not very good baseline that we began with. So we've seen him freeze and reverse some of the worst and most sweeping Trump directives, the travel bans, the harsh interior enforcement directive, some of the fee increases and barriers to benefits. And there's been a substantial change in tone from the last administration to this one, but there's still a long way to go. There's still a Title 42 health ban that's keeping immigrants seeking admission in peril at the southern border and elsewhere. We have over 10 million people living in the US, about 2/3 of them for more than 10 years who are undocumented and have no way to normalize their legal status. And the Biden administration is right now on track to resettle fewer refugees this year than any year under his predecessor. So there's a lot of work ahead that's the product not just of Trump, but of an immigration enforcement system historically and still very deeply entwined with our excessively punitive and racist systems.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that, Jennifer. And I'm sure we're going to come back to this idea of, you know, the floor and the ceiling, you know,
right.
How do we stop saying, thank goodness it's not Trump and the worst of those excesses are maybe being ameliorated towards pushing for what we really want. And then also this question of how far do we credit tone? You know, how it does land different to hear a president say some of the things that he's saying, but how do we translate that into substance and make sure we keep our eyes on that prize? So I'm gonna go finally on this first go round to Congressmember Mark Takano. Congressmember, every issue we're talking about today, we're talking about things where we're grateful for what change we've seen. We're trying to keep our eyes on the change we still need to see. We can see it as half a glass, half full or half empty, but everything we talk about, we keep talking about the obstructions to having the majority opinion, the thing that most people say they want, having that reflected in the actual policy and politics of our country. So I wanted to talk to you, to hear you talk about the potential of what is now the Democratic agenda and the possibilities of filling it. So we've seen this massive stimulus bill. We've seen the signing of a number of progressive and important executive orders. We've seen appointments, meaningful appointments. I'm not saying it's all symbolic, but appointments of cabinets and public servants that are really breaking barriers, and that matters. On the other hand, we have the magnanimity of the issues that actually face us, right? Police reform, voting rights reform, the Equality Act, the courts, so many pieces of legislation. And we have people wondering how we can possibly push them through, without Democratic control of Congress and this procedural obstacle, which is the filibuster. It's come up before. We're wondering, from your view inside the Beltway, what do we need to know about these procedural obstacles? And if these questions are as urgent as we know they are, what can we do to remove this lockjam?
Well, when you say we, I'm assuming you're meaning that people who are not members of Congress, people who, you know, are like people on the call, people who may not be professors, people who Rashad is out there organizing. So I will say straight out that Joe Biden is not governing like a restoration president. He might have been a candidate running as a restoration candidate, but what is, I think, truly striking is that he is not governing as a restoration figure. And even when he has these moments, like with the, and time will tell if what I'm saying will hold true, on the refugee caps, lifting those refugee caps, I was among the many, many signatories of a letter, led by Ilhan Omar, and I forget, maybe it might have been Pramila Jayapal, that called upon President Biden to lift those caps, that he reversed course. What saves this president in my eyes is his willingness to hear and to listen. And why is that? Well, it might have something to do with the fact that he knows that he owes his presidency to amazing organizing that went on in the state of Georgia. That even the AAPI population in Georgia, which went 60% in his favor, can claim to have been the margin of victory, along with the massive turnout of African Americans. This amazing notion that a deep South state like Georgia would have been, would have played such a role. And I think what weighs on this president is knowing that he can't govern like a restoration president. He has to govern aspirationally. He has to govern for the people who want to see a solution to 11 million people who are undocumented in this country. So I'm going to say something. I've been to Selma twice. I've walked across the Edmund Pettus Bridge twice. I've walked across it with John Lewis twice on the 50th anniversary of that march to Montgomery. And I'm going to say the Edmund Pettus Bridge of this moment, of this century, is the filibuster. And we will need to cross that bridge, whether it is with 10 Republican votes for cloture or zero Republican votes. We do need to cross that bridge. Kyrsten Sinema and Joe Manchin are not people riding backwards on a mule. What was the name of that guy who rode backwards on a mule from Arkansas? But anyway, you know what I'm talking about. They are not that person. And I think they know it. And whatever it is they got to do performance-wise until we decide we're going to cross that bridge, but we will cross that bridge because we need H.R. 1, election reform. We need the John Lewis Voting Rights Act. We need the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act, and not a watered-down policing act. We need the full-on effect of the immunity. Thank you. Well, that's a weird name for an immunity. It's not a qualified immunity because it's actually total immunity for those that use that immunity. Qualified my, you know what? So if we're going to get that through, along with reproductive freedom, along with lifting, the Hyde Amendment, along with all the other things that matter to the majority of those people, we've got to cross that bridge of an anti-majority, antiquated tool. And look, it is going to take us making it clear to the American people that this is what it's at stake. No less than our democracy is at stake. And I think Joe Biden did a tremendous job of saying that our job is to show that democracy can work. And how can we show democracy working when we're ceding ground to a minority that wants to cling to the past? We got to make it very clear in plain terms, but I think we explain it best not by explaining the procedure, but explaining what is at stake. You mean that we can't get rid of ghost guns because of this procedure that doesn't allow the Senate to vote, doesn't allow the majority of the Senate to vote on something. So this is action for the streets. This is action everywhere. But sooner or later, we need to confront it, and we will confront it. And I believe it will get done.
Thank you so much, Congressmember Takano, and all of our panelists for that initial go round on what we're seeing and what we need to do, and particularly for being concrete about legislation that's on the floor that we can fight for, and then also being aspirational, as we've just heard, about what we can wish for and what we can imagine, and then very specific about what's standing in the way. We're going to talk more about that, but first we're going to have a little social media check-in before we get on to a round table. So I'm going to ask African-American Policy Forum's Creative Arts Administrator, Owoye Timpo, to give us a brief rundown about what are we hearing online so far what are folks asking about, curious about, and then we're going to move into a roundtable discussion with our panelists. So Owoye.
Thanks so much, Janine. And there's so many thoughts and comments, just saying thank you to this incredible panel. And thank you to everybody who's in the chat for your incredible comments. There was a really great debate actually about the role of Kamala Harris. One person had mentioned that they're still reeling from her comments post-verdict and noted that they felt that her comments remarked her comments continue the erasure of Black female deaths at the hands of the police. That person noted that more than 250 women have been killed by the police since 2015. That then sparked a really vibrant debate about what her role is and how she can be useful. Another comment that prompted another comment that we shouldn't be impatient, give her some more time. Lots of different opinions, different strategies about how she might work beyond these 100 days, and a lot of rigorous debate on whether or not to give the administration more time to do what they are trying to do versus calls to keep pushing and pushing to prompt change. A couple other comments that stood out. One person commented that they hope that reproductive justice doesn't mean deterring Black women from childbirth. They said, let's not get confused and take Black women's right to away Black women's right to bear children. And another said they're interested in the FCC and Garland slapping sanctions and barriers on Fox News and other social media who spew misinformation. And lastly, there was a comment, which may actually be a question for later, saying there's very little we can do in 2 years with voting rights, choice, police reform, and infrastructure. So thank you so much to everybody who's in the chat. Lots of amazing conversation, really great debate going on. And we'll catch up with you later on in the show.
Thank you very much, Owoye. Well, let's get into a roundtable. I think one of the tensions that we're feeling from people is how patient should we be? And is that complacency? You know, what are we waiting for? And should we be pushing for it now? Not that there's a difference between those things, but you know, what do we win by waiting or by pausing, you know? And then it seems like there's a question of what do we actually expect of our leaders? What can we ask of them? And how much is on us to push for them? I think also when Congressmember Takano said, well, when we say we, what can we do? That means also the people on this call. And I think that's true. And I think a lot of people are tuning in precisely to hear how they might be involved in pushing these things forward. So I could put this question for anyone. I don't know if you can raise your hand, but I think folks want to know, should our emphasis now be sort of telling US citizens, look, this is how the power structure works. You know, you need to learn these details to learn how to work this system. And how much emphasis comparatively do we give to work that's really outside of traditional representative democracy? You know, we know that it's protests in the street that have got us to where we are now. I wonder how some of you talk to people who don't actually see the connection between what they're fighting for and plugging into, you know, write your Congress member. You know, they don't see that as the thing that they ought to do. How do we connect those things? And what do you suggest to people as a next step for something that they can do personally for involvement? If anyone, I could start with Rashad. Looks like he wants to answer that right away. So we could start with you, Rashad.
I don't know what that look was, but I'm gonna make sure I don't do it again next round. So look, my job is to drive strategic action. Color of Change was founded in the aftermath of a flood, which was Hurricane Katrina. It was caused by bad decision makers and turned into a life-altering disaster by bad decision makers. Black folks were literally on their roofs begging for the government to do something, and they were left to die. And the thing about Katrina, and the thing about COVID, and the thing about major moments like this is they oftentimes illustrate things that we already knew. In the case of Katrina, geographic segregation, generational poverty, the impacts of what we've done to our planet, all the ways in which structural racism undergirds those things. But at the heart of it, no one was nervous about disappointing Black people. government, corporations, and media. So this is not a question about whether or not we focus on government or whether we focus on corporations or whether we focus on media. We actually have to build power and leverage power against all the forces that can either stand in the way of change or can actually be part of the work. We also have to recognize that we can't mistake presence for power. Presence is visibility, awareness, retweets, shout outs from the stage. Presence is not necessarily a bad thing, but when we mistake presence for power, we can think that we've done something that we haven't actually done. So we can mistake a Black president for thinking that we're post-racial. We can mistake a lot of celebration for Black celebrities for people thinking that America loves Black people as much as America loves Black culture, and America can love, celebrate, and monetize Black culture and hate Black people at the same time. And so for us, when I think about strategic action, it means how do we direct the energy? How do we engage energy in ways that direct it at the places that can actually move things? So it's not about demanding that Mitch McConnell stand up for affirmative action, but it's about, because no amount of petitions, no amount of showing up is ever gonna get him to stand up for affirmative action, but it's about building strategies that build power, that either put people in office or take them out, that also then hold those accountable in once they're there for knowing that their jobs are sort of on the line if they don't deliver. And all of that has to be part of a larger sort of strategy. And so, I think that like strategic action is absolutely key. And I couldn't agree more with the congressman in terms of what is important for those of us who are everyday citizens looking for change. But at the same time, we have to recognize that the systems and the structures are designed to not move easily, designed to stall us, to design to create barriers towards things that are actually legitimate and structural. Someone mentioned Merrick Garland sort of levying fines, and they said the FCC. So it's very mixed up. But right now, there's actually really no rules for social media platforms that will hold them accountable in ways that are actually at any type of scale. The sort of fines that come from the FTC around antitrust or the potential sort of others are like the type of things that are like a vacation for Mark Zuckerberg. They're not actually at any type of scale to stop them from doing anything. So this gets us to the fact that we actually need real structural change. And far too often we tell stories about inequality that make us think that it's a car accident. Like it kind of just happened. Instead of that, it's structural. And so what ends up happening is we get charitable solutions to structural problems. And this is what we're going to have to guard against as we move outside of this 100 days. And the structural change is actually much harder, but it's actually the thing that over time will deliver the results that we can point to. It's actually why it's far too early to say anything about Biden and FDR in the same sentence, because that conversation around structural change, we haven't really got to yet. And it's gonna be incredibly hard to get there. But when we mistake sort of the unfortunate for the unjust, we do things like thinking it's enough to send water bottles to Flint instead of actually cleaning up the pipes, because actually cleaning up the pipes would have to deal with the tax policies that have allowed corporations to not pay their fair share and to allow a whole system that doesn't actually work. If we mistake sort of the unfortunate for unjust, we stop at reentry rather than actually dealing with mass incarceration. And this is a whole set of things that can make us feel like we've got to something that feels good. We have a Rose Garden ceremony, but it actually doesn't make the sort of long-lasting fundamental change in people's lives. And that's why strategic action, that's why building power, and that's why recognizing the difference between presence and power, always focused on the idea that power is the ability to change the rules. Sometimes they are the written rules of policy, other times they are the unwritten rules of culture. But when we change the rules, we can actually move things forward over time and build on that power for more and more change.
Thank you so much, Rashad, for all of that. Alexis, I wanted to ask you just to build on what you had mentioned before about the situation in which you are listened to as a policy advocate. You get into the room, you get Congress members and legislators who say they're with you on questions of reproductive justice, which, you know, of course, has to do with women being able to choose whether or not or when they want to have families, and is not just about access to abortion. It's an expansive understanding of what reproductive justice really means. But you've talked about the fact that you can go all that way and then somehow in the hashing things out, somehow you, those concerns drop away when they are the concerns of a majority of the US population. I wondered if you could just talk a little bit about concretely how we address that. And I would ask all our panelists to be thinking about concrete pieces of legislation, concrete actions, concrete things that people can tap into today. We recognize that this is a big, expansive, ongoing project, but what are things that folks can kind of set their minds on right now? And so Alexis, I wanted to ask you, what do you see, like, if you care about reproductive justice and whether the Biden administration is going to continue this silence from last night, what can they do tomorrow to start speaking into that silence?
Well, I mean, I think that what was interesting about last night is that while Biden didn't say abortion last night and hasn't said it, you know, in the last 100 days, Republican Senator Tim Scott did in his rebuttal, right? So we know kind of what the opponent's playbook is already on these issues. They are going to be relentless in their pursuit of power. They understand where to press the buttons. And oftentimes when pro-sexual and reproductive health politicians don't say anything, they're actually leaving kind of half the brain space for the other side to fill in their thoughts around it. And I think that's seeding the ground. I think that tends to be what we do largely on the left when we are engaged in these fights. And that's why I think it is so important for the kind of work that A Color of Change is doing under Rashad's leadership, because it is helping us get unconfused, right, around the idea that what are majoritarian issues, whether we're talking about race, we're talking about reproductive rights and justice. Again, there is no state in the country, no state, where supporting Roe or supporting broad expansion of sexual and reproductive health care is unpopular. That is a majoritarian issue. And yet when you have these vocal minorities controlling the levers of power, what that tells me is that they have weaponized rules change as a way of transforming the way in which we do business together. And somehow we have confused the kind of center of Congress being isolated around Senator Manchin and Sinema, at least on our issues, to be the center of where Americans are. And we know that that is actually not where the majority of people are. So the question, the work that we have to do, and I do believe that education is, you know, is the balm. Education really does help us understand and distinguish between the difference between what is a majoritarian issue and what is a governing issue. And how do we force people into the positions of actually governing? We look back at the playbooks, right? When the right has had power, they have relentlessly and ruthlessly focused on rules change. We looked at this, like I always say, kind of in this role right now, 2021 for me is halftime. I feel like we're in the locker room. 2010 was when they focused on rules change. They transformed with the census, not just how Congress was gerrymandered, but also all of these state legislatures that gave rise to the number of restrictions that we're seeing in states. And I think the Trump administration has accelerated many of those factors over the last 4 years that Biden is just now beginning to undo, right? Weaponizing racial and gender anxiety, weaponizing xenophobia, packing the courts with judges who would be anti-sexual and reproductive health. And that is really the kind of landscape that we are trying to address right now. And so I think what's really important for folks who are listening is both to get the education around, you know, how has power been codified and organized in this way? How has the media amplification on the right, which is at the intersection of race and anti-sexual and reproductive health, impacting policy and creating and minimizing the opportunities for us to advocate? Those are the things that I think are going to be really important for us to, you know, get ourselves organized. And I just have to say a quick plug for the law students in the audience. Planned Parenthood of Los Angeles has launched a collaboration with UCLA Law for the first ever UCLA Law Institute on Reproductive Health Law and Policy. So thinking about the ways in which we connect the dots between these big systems and these structures and inform policy and law, you know, those are the things that are actually going to help us train leaders for the future of this fight and think about how we get involved and make sure particularly the next generation understands what's at stake and how all of these issues intersect, because that's what they're asking us for. They want to understand the playbook. And I think that's what we have to be prepared to deliver.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that. I love a conversation that talks about power, you know, that says, frankly, this is what we're talking about. And power is the ability to change the rules. Let's stop thinking that we need to play by them and then our turn will come. We understand that this is about changing the rules. And with that in mind, Jennifer, I wanted to go briefly to you. What does this mean, power changing the rules in terms of immigration policy? I mean, we have seen immigration rights advocates in the news, on the front lines for years now. How is that translating or not translating into actual changes? For example, on the border, you know, which was this very dramatic case under the Trump administration. And now it seems like things are different, but they're different in a way that maybe is just surface. Are we seeing power to change the rules on immigration advocacy?
That's a great question. I think in some ways we heard President Biden making his pitch yesterday when he talked about the need for legislation around immigration. And that's been that's been a pitch that previous presidents have also made and unsuccessfully. And I think this is another space where we often see popular ideas go to die and where we've repeatedly seen things like a legislative solution for long-term residents to have a path to legalization and citizenship, not making it through the Senate, in part because of the anti-majoritarian structure of the Senate, coupled with the very anti-majoritarian filibuster. So popular popular programs, popular legislation, popular measures in this space don't have wind up kind of falling flat, not because they're not supported by the majority of the people, but because the way the power is structured complicates that. So we have a block around legislation that it's going to be difficult to overcome without fundamentally re-examining Senate rules, among other things. And we also have, kind of going back to what Alexis was saying earlier when she talked about courts, we have a court structure that has been heavily packed over the last 4 years so that we have a lot of federal judges who are going to be hostile to certain more favorable forms of executive discretion when it comes to immigration policy. So there are a lot of roadblocks and barriers both to legislative solutions and to discretionary executive policies around enforcement that this administration is going to have to work its way through. I did want to though sort of think about power and how it's effectuated here. And I want to think about the way that a lot of the activism and organizing, which has been amazing in this space, has really reshaped the world of the possible. So we know that the deferred action for childhood arrival programs has been heavily embattled, but remains, which is a testament first and foremost to the amazing organizing work that was done by people with really lives on the line who made this issue a priority for not just politicians, but for people who didn't have a stake in that fight. And so I think that kind of continued work we can expect to see, and that can move things. And I want to sort of go to the level of rhetoric, because I think it's important. So we talked a little bit earlier about the fact that during the State of the Union address, President Biden talked about systemic racism more than once in his statement. He talked about white supremacy's terrorism, as you mentioned in your opening remarks. So we see this shift in rhetoric that is made possible by movement action, right? That changes the way that politicians see the political terrain and changes what they think is possible to talk about. And I think that's happening as well in the immigration space. So the Department of Homeland Security recently issued a directive to its immigration and customs enforcement agents and its customs and border protection agents to refrain from using the terms alien and illegal alien when referring to non-citizens. A small thing, maybe, but a really important thing, because it shows the way that the administration has been moved to talk about immigration in a way that is less dehumanizing, that's rooted in an acknowledgement of people's humanity, and to ask their enforcement agents to acknowledge that. So that doesn't change all of the problems around the sort of enforcement structures that we have, but it does signal that there is more political space to push here than there was before, and that political space has been opened by this activism. We certainly still see a lot of headwinds that this administration administration will have to push against to effectuate change on the ground. So you talked about the situation on the southern border after sort of a lot of agitation around the building of a wall, the Remain in Mexico policy that left tens of thousands of asylum seekers on the Mexican side of the border. We have real work to do, and it's slow changing there. So there are still over 20,000 people in the Remain in Mexico program waiting for their asylum claims to be heard, or waiting even to be able to be moved out of Remain in Mexico. And so that's a real and constant threat to people's lives. So when we talk about what's too fast, what's too slow, how hard do we push? We know that in the space of criminal legal enforcement, we know that in the space of immigration enforcement, we know that in the space of asylum, people are dying every day. People's lives are at risk every day. We know this in the space of reproductive justice as well. So if we're confronted with this sort of daily harm, then there is always an urgency that remains, no matter how fast and how well we think an administration is moving, to continue to keep these harms visible, to continue to elevate the dangers and the risks of existing policies, and to continue to push harder for something to go faster. You talked at the outset about the fact that there's still children in custody. The kids in cages were sort of a hallmark of Trump administration policies. And we've seen a real decrease in the number of kids who are in Customs and Border Protection custody at the border, and a lot faster shifts to the Office of Refugee Resettlement custody and then on to placement. So that's a good thing, but it means that there are still young people who are in detention, and there are ways in which our laws and policies interact to increase the likelihood that that's going to continue to happen. The parents are going to continue to send children alone into the country. And so until we sort of address those root problems, we will have this recurring kind of inhumanity at the border. And that's something that we still need to confront. So there's progress, and there's work to do, and the work is important because the stakes are incredibly high. And we've seen the potential of political power to move the conversation and to change the terrain of the possible.
Thank you. Thank you so much for that. I just want to say, in a minute, we're going to go for a kind of lightning round, a little real quick round for folks talking about action and inspiration. But I did want to give Congressman Mark Takano an opportunity to respond to this question as the person closest perhaps to one of the sorts of power that we're talking about. We're talking about how we have multiple, places and centers of power in this country. But as a member of Congress, let me put it to you. I mean, first of all, when people wonder why their majority support for an idea or for a vision or for a concept doesn't translate into what our representative democracy does, How do you explain that and keep them talking to you? We're talking about the way that presidents say, yes, I want to do this, now go out there and make me do it, and the relationship between social movements and political action. How do you explain that to constituents in a way that doesn't frustrate them and that encourages them to stay active when they know how power works and doesn't work?
Well, I'm going to tell two very quick stories. One is how Speaker Pelosi always refers to Lincoln's dicta of the will, of generating public will, public sentiment. With public sentiment, anything is possible. Without it, nothing's possible. And that the objective of organizing and organizing and organizing is to make any issue too hot to handle for the politicians. That when there's popular will, we in Washington, your representatives, have the ability to make something or anything possible. So focus back on that organizing principle. Second, always take a kind of the spiritual view that John Lewis did. The day that Justice Kennedy retired from the court, John Lewis and I rode up in an elevator together to go vote, and he saw me looking disconsolate in the elevator. I hadn't realized that I was. And he said, "What's the matter, brother?" And I kind of was a little embarrassed. I said, "Well, I'm really upset about Justice Kennedy retiring from the court." And he said, "Don't you worry. We're going to get through this together." And we went and voted. And I went back to my office and saw his tweet. And his tweet said, that was a tweet where he said, you know, ours is not the battle of a day, a week, a month, or a year. Ours is the battle of a lifetime. That we can't get stuck in the bad news of the moment, and to take the long view. And here was a guy, you know, who got hit on the head, sacrificed in his body, and saw the long march it took to realize something. So we have to hold those two things, I think, in our heart. But I want to talk about the two things that I think we need to focus on right now. One is the filibuster. And it may not be a complete reform. It may be just we open it up a little bit. And I think the first thing, the tip of the spear, is HR 1 and HR 4. Voting rights and election reform, getting rid of gerrymanders, that is what is really essential to saving our democracy. But even opening up that filibuster that much will be an opening through which eventually everything is going to rush through. It will be what that is what we've got to do. Second, we've got to do what the right has done on the courts. We've got to impress upon our people to be able to turn out over judicial appointments, over the Supreme Court, because that is also going to be a barrier to our being able to actually implement the laws that we pass and to make sure that they're not compromised later. So that's what I got to say in terms of what we got to practically focus on.
That's very exciting. I appreciate that. And we're going to continue with just that energy with a go through now with 1 minute, real brief, just for participants who they're sitting with it. You know, they've absorbed what we've all been talking about. And now they're like, now they want to know maybe an action, a concrete thing that they might not know about, but also maybe an inspiration, you know, maybe just an idea that hasn't been said yet that you think, you know what, there's a place for this in this conversation, or something you want to say to people about what they can do tomorrow. Just a real quick before we close, go round of each of us to do a real brief kind of, you know, whatever you want to do with a final minute on this first 100 days conversation. Rashad, I'm not going to you first because I see you looking at me like that. I'm going to go actually to Alexis first on this. Just some concluding thoughts, action, inspiration, anything forward-looking and concrete. Yep.
Well, thank you. I appreciate that. And I appreciate you coming to me because I want to pick up on the congressman's points. You know, I do think that part of what is happening in this moment is that the outside game is as organized and strong as the inside game. That's actually what helps us build power, right? It is in that make me do moment. And it allows us, quite frankly, I think, to have a bigger imagination, to have a bigger possibility, to have a bigger vision. I'm reminded my sister, Reverend Leah Daughtry, always says, you know, you can go up to the mountaintop and you can see a big vision. You can dream from the mountaintop, but trees don't grow on mountaintops, right? There's no oxygen for the trees to grow up there. You have to come down to the ground and actually do the work to make it happen. And I think that is the real opportunity in this moment that we have, you know, whether we are looking at Biden's big vision, whether we have a more inclusive vision, that great society that is way more inclusive, that actually allows Black people and all these other people to participate in at this moment, that allows reproductive freedom in this moment. I think there's a way for us to dream and imagine a lot bigger, but then come down and do the work and actually hold ourselves and each other accountable around what that means. And that means challenging, you know, making sure people understand that Hyde is not just a reproductive issue, it is a racist issue. And we actually should not have discriminatory legislation that is included and allowed to be part of bills, that we are engaging again in conversations around climate and the economy that don't allow reproductive rights to be a bargaining chip. And so if I can hold water, you know, and understand that it isn't the plastic water, that I'm holding the pipes that Rashad talked about in Flint, that reproductive rights and other issues are also part of that infrastructure and engaging in it. So I would love to encourage anyone who's listening to think in a very inspirational way of how to really live at the intersection and build an infrastructure at the intersection, because it's not coalition building, right? We're not just coming together to advance a couple of really big American families' jobs, you know, and help bills. We are coming together to really set the course for the next 100 years. And what will it mean if all of our issues are at that intersection and operationalized in a way where we are all carrying that? To me, that is the vision that is guiding us from the work that we need to do to really grow the trees and give the oxygen and the air back to the people to do that.
Thank you so, so much. Jennifer, final thoughts, actions, concrete actions, inspiration, things that folks can do?
Thank you. So I'm thinking of my law students here and thinking about the way that when now that Biden is in office, there's a lot of shift of attention to the federal government, and rightly so. There seem to be the possibility for things to happen in the space of the federal government. But I think one of the lessons that's been sort of hard learned and was really important over the last few years was how much space can be created at the local, at the community level, at the municipal level, at the city level, and how important sustained attention to what happens in those local spaces continues to be. So people who are sort of organizing and doing the political work that way know this, but I think folks who are training to be lawyers frequently forget this and look to the things that sort of mirror their casebooks. And I just want to remind us that a lot of power is built in small spaces, and that power becomes really important as a bulwark against forces at the bigger levels that are sometimes marshaled against the most vulnerable. So just keeping our eye on all levels of government, on all levers of power, I think is really important in this moment.
Thank you so much, Jennifer. Congressmember Mark Takano, you got very concrete and action-oriented just a second ago, but I do want to give you one brief chance to just offer some final thoughts in terms of inspiration, in terms of how you stay inspired, and briefly what you would like folks to jump on right now.
Well, that John Lewis story is a big guidepost for me. I always use it as a point of reference. If anyone had a right to kind of be pessimistic, it was him. And he said, you know, be optimistic, be hopeful. That was the beginning of that tweet I was talking about. Be optimistic and be hopeful. We have a duty. We have a moral duty to be optimistic, actually, is what I conclude. We have a moral duty to be optimistic. Jennifer, you're absolutely right. People forget about the power of the local sheriff. Why aren't we being more careful about who gets elected sheriff, for God's sake? I mean, huge difference who the sheriff is. Huge difference who the city council is, who determines who the police chief is, right? Like, don't forget, local power is also important, and vote in every election, right? Organize. And look, Black Lives Matter did matter. They're passing laws everywhere to suppress protesters. And they wouldn't be doing that unless they had an effect. We passed George Floyd Justice Policing Act twice through the House of Representatives. Unthinkable before Black Lives Matter. So you bet Black Lives Matter, but you all out in the streets matter, but always have a concrete objective. What is it you want to achieve? All right. I don't think you all knew that when it began, but that's what I got to say.
Thank you. And Rashad, we're going to go to you finally. Be as concrete or as inspirational or whatever you want to be in this final minute or so of our conversation. And thank you.
Great to be with you all and with my fellow panelists. The thing I will leave folks with is that budgets are moral documents. As we're trying to figure out how to pass policy, how we're trying to move things through tight sort of legislatures, whether we're at the local level, the national level, budgets say more about what we care about than any given speech. And so how we engage the budgeting process is incredibly important. If folks say that they actually want to prosecute more fraud and corruption and prosecute less low-level drug offenses, you actually need more money for that because billionaires have more lawyers, they have more researchers. And so the budgets actually have to reflect what people say, and we actually have to change people's engagements with government. You know, if the IRS is only auditing or mostly auditing low-level women of color, but low-level folks, women of color, people with, you know, less income, then what we end up with is a whole situation where people's first and only engagement with government is bad. And so we have to change that. And the final thing I will say is that we end up over and over again setting ourselves up for failure with how we talk about the issues, the structural issues. Black people are not less likely to get a loan from the bank. Banks are less likely to give loans to Black people. When we say Black people are less likely to give a loan to the banks, then we end up with financial literacy programs that are meant to help Black people do better inside of institutions which have targeted, exploited, and left us out from the very beginning. When we say banks are less likely to give loans to Black people, we actually focus our energy on actually dealing with the banks. So we have to change the fact that we far too often put a passive voice on the systems and an active voice on the people. And we have to switch that around, because unless we actually tell stories that put the communities most impacted, not as charity, not as harmed, but as the protagonist in their own stories. Who is a better protagonist in the American story of voting and democracy than Black people, which have waited on long lines, faced more indignities, faced threats of violence and death in order to express our will for a better future, regardless of whether we are privileged or vulnerable in the majority or the minority in certain areas, or in favor or out of favor with whoever may be individually in office in that case. And so to the extent that we have to tell new stories, the communities most impacted by the structural challenges are not vulnerable. They have been targeted, attacked, and exploited. Vulnerability is a personal trait. Let's not focus on how we fix Black folks and brown folks and women and our families. Let's focus on how we fix the systems which have harmed, exploited, and targeted us from the very beginning. If we can deal with things like budgets, if we can deal with things like the structural way we talk about stories, it will be a force multiplier for building the type of long-term power that deals with all of the forces that stand in the way of change, that actually helps us expand more people to be part of our coalitions. And I think eventually will give us the power to win more, win bigger, and win the type of change that's lasting.
Well, all right. On that benediction, I want to thank you all, panelists and participants, for joining us. This remarkable conversation with vision and concrete ideas, understanding the limited power of symbol, the need to fight in multiple arenas, to understand structural inequities and to communicate that understanding, to focus our efforts on where it matters and to build power. This conversation would not have been possible without the time and effort of the team at the Williams Institute, at the African American Policy Forum, the Center for Intersectionality and Social Policy Studies, the Critical Race Studies Program, and of course, our fantastic panelists. Thank you so much, Rashad Robinson, Alexis McGill Johnson, Jennifer Chacón, and Congressmember Mark Takano. I hope that everyone will keep up with these sorts of conversations with your friends and your family and within your communities. And please join the fight to make sure that these conversations remain possible. We have to have them to make sure that anti-speech efforts don't stifle the social justice debates and conversations that we know we need to have. In several states, we know that there are efforts to build on Trump's ban on structural racism, on the 1619 Project, on critical race theory. We know that's already happening. It's impacting an entire generation. So if you haven't already, please do take a moment to join Policy Forum's Truth Be Told campaign on that set of issues by going to aapf.org/truthbetold. And you can find out how to protect conversations like the one we just had, the vital conversation we just had, from censorship. So you can learn more about all of our organizations and the programs and the collaborations that have been shouted out during this fantastic conversation in some links that you will find. And you can still also, of course, please look out for the Policy Forum's podcast, Intersectionality Matters, hosted by Kimberly Crenshaw. We're going to post the conversation we had here tonight on the podcast Intersectionality Matters in the coming weeks. Thank you so much, all of you, for joining us. Until next time, please stay safe as we continue to organize and to resist. Thank you.
coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes, it will. Then I go to my brother and I say, brother, help me please. But he winds up knocking me back down on my coming, but I know change gonna come.